reasons why Samuel had stopped by to see Joseph this evening was because he wanted to try to enlist Joseph in his freedom struggle against the Romans. "I have a cure for loneliness," murmured Samuel, a gleam in his inkberry eyes. "I can guess," he laughed. Joseph chuckled with private amusement. He thought that maybe Samuel would ask him to go and have some kind of a fling with any of the young girls of Nazareth. But Samuel looked at him seriously and said, "I've long ago given up trying to make an adult out of you, Joseph. No amorites, no little love affairs for you. Of course you don't know what you're missing, but that's not what I was thinking about at all. My thoughts for your future were elsewhere." "Where then?" asked Joseph. "Jerusalem," said Samuel, mentally seeing Jerusalem in his mind. "Are there not enough carpenters in the big city?" "Carpenters, bah! Joseph, don't you ever have a thought beyond your work?" Joseph blinked self-consciously. "Why, yes, Samuel, I think about many things that have nothing at all to do with my work." "What, for instance?" asked Samuel. "Oh, the law," replied Joseph. "Bah, the law. Who cares about the law of God?" "Bah," repeated Joseph with a wag of his head. "Bah is not an argument, Samuel. It is a noise." "It has a meaning just the same. It means that I and many others like me are tired of being taught about the patriarchs and the judges and the prophets, the history of Israel. We are tired of more than that. We have had enough of being ruled by foreign powers. We are all slaves run by Herod for the benefit of Rome. And what has Rome to do with us? We want to be free." "Oh," said Joseph, "that again. Better lower your voice, Samuel." The danger was real. Roman spies were everywhere. It was folly to take part in political discussions with the police listening, holding the downtrodden people in a misery of fear. One learned not to speak ideas aloud. In the last century, there had been a series of hapless rebellions in the land. Fierce and fanatical men still roamed the hills of Galilee, striking at Romans when they dared. Some of the best of the young men of the province, healthy and strong ones, enthusiastic ones, had perished in those feeble and foredoomed revolts. Thousands of patriots dying for Israel during the 100 years the Romans had held Israel. Not only Galilee, of which Nazareth was one of the chief towns, did they hold, but Judea too, with Jerusalem, the golden capital. All the territory that once had known the valor of Joshua, the power of David, the wisdom and glory of Solomon, was now paying tribute to the Emperor Augustus Caesar. Ah, Samuel could tell Joseph, conditions were getting much worse. Rich and powerful men of their own nation were collaborating with the invaders, fattening their fortunes by betraying their own people. How long must they endure slavery with treason thrown in? Did Joseph realize that in every village young men were once more plotting to throw the Romans out and make the people free? Why should Joseph not join? Ever since Joseph could remember, impetuous youths in Nazareth had been planning a secret, melodramatic resistance against the Romans, but it never came to anything more than talk. "Don't you love your own country?" prodded Samuel reproachfully. "Aren't you one of us in spirit at least?" Joseph's smile was quizzical. Poor workman that he was, he belonged to the house of David, and his line ran back, clearly indicated in the scrolls of the Nazareth synagogue, all the way to Jacob, who was of Isaac, who was of Abraham, and farther than that, even to Seth, who was of Adam, who was of God. The smile deepened as he patted the knee of his impetuous friend. This revolutionist really did want to save Israel. But how? By uprising? By blood? By death?